Welcome to the Climate Buzz podcast. The Climate Buzz is hosted by Dr. Bob Hanna, Kelly Sheehan, and Brad Rouse. Each week we share with you the stories, the people, the science, the challenges, and the solutions of a warming planet. We invite you to like and follow our Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube pages, where we promise to keep you up on all the latest climate buzz and share the links, information, and footage discussed on the show. The Climate Buzz originally aired live on Asheville FM, a nonprofit, volunteer-powered community radio station based in Asheville, North Carolina. Asheville FM is dedicated to producing diverse and eclectic programming that inspires our listeners to build connections across communities and to discover new music and ideas. The Climate Buzz airs live on Mondays, 9 to 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. It can be heard locally on 103.3 FM and streamed and archived at www.ashevillefm.org. Today's show aired live on July 10, 2023 on Asheville FM with Bob Hanna, Brad Rouse, and guest Michelle Meyer, who's the chair of the Blue Horizons Community Council, leading the way in achieving its community-wide renewable energy goals, enlisting public support, and providing easy access to resources that allow everyone to be part of creating a clean energy future. Enjoy. Welcome to the Climate Buzz. I'm Bob Hanna.
And I'm Brad Rouse.
And we're committed to sharing with you the people, the stories, the science, the challenges, and the solutions for a warming planet. It's July 10, 2023, and the current level of global carbon dioxide in our atmosphere is 422.52. All opinions and words shared on the Climate Buzz are those of the people who speak them and not the station or underwriters of the station. Well, good morning, Brad.
Good morning, Bob.
We finally heard from Kelly this week. Yeah. She peeked her nose out of her sabbatical at this point, huh?
Yeah, well, I guess sometimes people just turn off all the input. We have so much of it these days with all the emails and cell phones and text messages and everything else. You just need to turn it off for a while. Slow down.
It is good for the soul, isn't it?
It is. To unplug it is. I don't seem to be able to do it, but I just go continual news junkie.
You're a machine, bro. I just tell you, man, just sucking in information, you know.
I don't know. I had surgery a year and a half ago. I slowed down a little bit for a few weeks after that. So
we are excited to have a guest today in the studio. Joining us is Michelle Myers, and she serves as the chair of the Blue Horizons Project Community Council that advises the work of the Blue Horizons Project that's leading the way to a cleaner, affordable, and smarter energy future rooted in community engagement and collaboration in the Western North Carolina region. And Michelle, thanks so much for joining us on the Climate Buzz.
Hi, Bob. Great to be here.
Yeah, so good to have you.
Yeah, good to have you.
It's just been two boys in the studio for a while, so it's nice, you know, to get a little mix here. So
yeah, absolutely.
Well, did you holding on to the news? Are you kind of watching the climate news and keeping up with all of
it? It's just a continual avalanche, which is good and bad.
I mean, it's going to be a rough day today, I think. Although we've got some hopeful stories too. We try to do both, Michelle. And
I've got a couple of hopeful stories.
But you can't ignore, you know, that between, I think it was July 3rd and 5th, we experienced the three hottest days ever. On the planet.
Well, actually, and there were four days. One day was tied with the other. Yeah. So actually, there were 4 days that were the four hottest days ever.
Yeah. So, you know, and it's there's a lot of things going into this, of course, but we're watching here on the North America, Mexico and the Southwest and Texas, in a heat dome that just is not going to move on. I saw something that said Phoenix is expected to have 18 consecutive days above 110 degrees.
I just feel so lucky to be here in Nashville.
I know.
Where we've had relatively mild weather.
Well, that takes us back to our other story, right? Where we are kind of climate migration. You know, people are going to be looking for these higher ground and cooler places to live as you know, the South becomes more and more intolerable
actually,
in ways.
Yeah, yeah. And actually, Bob, and this is to play onto that story,
I do have a few more on it.
But this is directly related that NRDC, National Resources Defense Council, mm-hmm. just released a report that focused on the economic costs of extreme heat in North Carolina. Was that on your radar?
That's a great story, Brad. Tell us more. I want to hear about that.
Well,
honestly,
they did,
because I was thinking about, you know, what's the impact of these heat waves, right?
Well, they did a statistical study, and it there's more visits to the hospital. It's correlated, and some of the, you know, the employer heat costs, you know, employer costs go up as a result of that. So it has an economic impact, and it especially affects, they looked at four industries, and one of them that had a lot of effect on was trucking and cartage. You know, if you think of these people who deliver your FedEx and UPS packages and Amazon and whatever, whoever else is driving around and they're getting out of their car and going to your door.
So many
around
business.
Here is not so bad, but you get into places where it's 110, 120 degrees out there, and you know, you, those people really have a hard time. And you know, if they're any, at all health challenged or whatever, then it just becomes doubly hard for them to do that work. And so that's all. I mean, study was released. So people are looking at this, and this has an economic cost. It's, you know, these days of extreme heat. So
huge. You know, and let alone the strain on the electrical grid, you know, that happens with these kind of, you know, with all the air conditioners running and such, you know, it's solar. I know.
I'm really, one thing to spin this in a little more positive direction is the solution, you know, is part of the solution of extreme heat is also the solution for mitigating our emissions, right? If everyone had a high efficiency air conditioner heating unit and solar on their roof, they'd be more resilient, and they'd be able to weather these days.
And the grid would be more resilient because, you know, some of the things that everybody says, oh, these are dependable sources of power, you know, your nuclear and your natural gas. I mean, they have, and they're supposed to be there and available for extreme cold. But you know what? They don't have reliability problems in extreme heat and extreme cold.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, solar is what's just saving Texas right now from being way out of line with what the needs are for all the air conditioners running all the time simultaneously, which is what's going on.
That's where it's working, isn't it?
And so that doesn't really add to the carbon emissions, and it sort of puts to a lie some of the antagonisms about renewable energy that you've found in Texas.
Yeah, they're kind of doing that under the table, aren't they? The solar and wind development of Texas is really quite.
There's a lot of money going into
significant, in support, you know.
Yeah,
they've been doing it for a long time though. Wind has been down there forever. I don't know if it's under the radar. It's just they're doing everything. They're still extracting fossil fuels, but they are building out clean energy infrastructure as well.
Yeah,
I just always think of Texas as kind of the oil state, and they're not really kind of talking about, you know, in some ways, hey, we got to do more of this, right? That's where I kind of see it not happening
Texas
so much.
And I think, you know, Oklahoma and Kansas and some of those states up there have tremendously untapped resources for wind energy, especially that just because of the thing we talked about last week with Brad Copperthorne, the need for permitting reform that they can't get.
Oh, yeah.
The energy to the rest of the country because we need more transmission to do that.
Yeah, yeah. Well, part of the warmer temperatures, which the New York Times reports that, you know, it is 2.9 degrees Fahrenheit warmer than typical for this time of year, breaking previous records by an unusually large margin. So, and it was just on last Tuesday that global average temperatures climbed to 60.26 degrees Fahrenheit, making it the hottest day Earth has experienced since we started measuring temperature in 1940. And part of that comes along with is we have moved into a new weather pattern called El Nino. We've left behind La Nina, and with El Nino comes warmer weather patterns, as well as significant warming of the ocean surface temperature, that the North Atlantic is warmer than it's ever been now. And which is not, you know, these kind of all are converging at a time that that they expect that we've got a lot of warm, hot weather ahead of us.
You know, it's funny when you mentioned that 62.6, and, you know, I had somebody mention to me, well, that's not so bad. What if it does get a little warmer? 62, 63 degrees, that's pretty warm. But, you know, what you don't realize is that's the average between, you know, the southern and the northern hemisphere, and it's winter. It's winter down in the southern hemisphere, so it's the average temperature that we're looking at, and the fact that it's much higher, not the absolute level of that temperature.
Yeah. The best representation is, you know, you can Google and see a map of the globe, and they kind of have the color shades, and they show, you know, where it's
difference from
extremely hot to extremely cold. So it's kind of a, you know, a rainbow from blue to red of different colors, and you see this band of red, bright, dark red, you know, coming down the middle of the band of the Earth, that, you know, those countries in that pathway are the ones that are getting hit the hardest for sure.
Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And it's the extreme. I mean, the fact of the matter is not just the average, it's the fact that with the warming of the Arctic, you're getting more of these heat domes because the jet stream has weakened so that heat domes, cold domes, rain domes.
Everything's moving slower, right? Because it's
moving slower. It's moving more erratically. Weather systems tend to sort of fix in place because there's not as much of a jet stream to sort of move them around and distribute. And so you get these experiences. Really, I think Catherine Hayhoe, that well-known climate scientist out of Texas, who said it was not just, it's not climate warming so much, or not global warming so much as global weirding. The weather is just getting weirder.
Yeah, that's a great way to say it.
Yeah.
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 So, you know, I just thought that, you know, again, in the article, you know, there were still people saying, you know, this is just normal, you know, weather. It's hot for some time and then it gets cold, and not willing to say, hey, there's a whole science behind kind of why what we understand is what's happening to the Earth. So even in the midst of all this heat wave, many people just look at this and say, well, it just gets hot this time of year and sometimes hotter than normal. Yeah. And they don't want to kind of factor in the idea of climate change.
Yeah. And I something that came across my radar this week that relates to that, which was, I was reading a Twitter, I think it was on Twitter, and somebody made the comment that, oh, well, carbon dioxide is only 0.04% of the atmosphere. How can that be causing warming? You know, my response was, yeah, well, that 0.04%, and I came up with a new response to that, because I hear that all the time. It's such a small percentage of the atmosphere. It's actually a very large percentage of the greenhouse, because so much of the atmosphere is not. Oxygen and nitrogen are both not really greenhouse gases. So they represent by far the largest part of our atmosphere. But my response to that comment was a new one, when it was like, okay, well, 0.04% of the atmosphere doesn't sound like a lot, does it? But that's enough to enable all plant life on the planet to live.
Wow.
If we didn't, it must be quite a bit, because that allows all plants to live. So how could that be a small amount?
Yeah. Who are you arguing with? That,
this is just the unnamed.
That's their sticking point. They're a small percentage overall.
Look, I'm, and maybe on LinkedIn and Twitter.
There are a lot of bots.
There are bots, and there are also people who would like to be a bot, but they just can't quite make it, and they're actually people.
The spin machine. You're the spin machine.
And there are some. I think there's a group of people who, you know, you read the biographies on LinkedIn, oil and gas executive or something like that. I mean, you know, there are people, especially on LinkedIn, because they, you know, a lot of people in fossil fuel industry are out there. And so they have willingly accepted what's coming down from their managements about why this isn't a problem, or what's just, they would rather be in denial of the fact that the business that they work for is causing very difficult problems. And indeed, I know you worked in this area, extinction of species and everything else. They just would rather not believe it, so they latch on to these arguments. And I think that's so much, even the person, your normal person who drives around in a gas guzzler and likes it or whatever, they have an incentive not to want to think that they're contributing to this problem.
Yeah. I read this book, Electrify, by Saul Griffin.
Oh,
you read it? Yeah. He really makes the case for how
really
we're going to...
Can you say that again? So
Electrify by Saul Griffin.
Okay.
And he makes a wonderful... I'm going to bring up a lot of what he said in that book in this segment today. Yeah, but one thing he pitches really hard is how we actually utilize the knowledge base of the oil and gas industry and of our utilities, who have been getting power around for 100 years now, doing a relatively good job of it, and how we make them allies. And it might mean we have to buy out their stranded assets, you know, but just pay them, because it's going to cost us a lot more money to adapt to climate change if we don't stop them from exploiting those assets, which we were just talking about Texas, right? They're sitting on a lot of natural gas right now, and they're getting ready to open it up in the Permian Basin. They are opening it up in the Permian Basin and Oklahoma and Kansas, actually. All that little strip you were just talking about, that wind bank is also a fossil fuel bank, unfortunately. So how do we get them to leave it in the ground and then utilize, you know, take this narrative that they've all convinced themselves of? You know, they say, well, the economies are growing in China. They're going to need all of this stuff that we're extracting. It's not just for the United States. We could electrify everything in the United States, but they're still going to need it, right? How do we harness that narrative internally in the oil and gas industry and start making them an ally in the conversion to all renewable energy is really what we have to do, because we can't just keep having this kind of culture clash. It's getting us nowhere, and we're already at the hottest day ever, right? Yeah. So we need to somehow get these people on board and stop making them the enemy, because they have done what they were tasked with doing, which is supplying us with heat and electricity for 100 years.
Yeah.
So we just have to show them the pathway to be billionaires in the new kind of new clean renewable energy future, right? Because that's what they're going to accept, right? If they can continue to make their profit margins, then you know, but we can have that invested into, you know, clean renewable energy, then maybe we get to kind of, you know, starve off the worst of what is kind of happening to the planet. Yeah.
It's hard to swallow, though, isn't
it? I know.
It's so hard to swallow. But
because there's another
side.
Maybe
some of them can just retire out.
Oh, well, sure, they are. They are. You know, there is going to be a shift, but, you know.
Well, I'll tell you, you know, this is another news story, and I'll just pop it in real quick. And it's that Biden is sending John Kerry over to China to continue climate negotiations with China, which, you know,
which
New York Times kind of bills as the two largest polluters in the world are going to get together and talk about climate. And part of what kind of Nancy Pelosi went and visited Taiwan, and that got China all upset, because there's a whole story about, you know, Taiwan in some ways functionally is independent, but they're not allowed to say they're independent of China. And so by Nancy going there, she recognized Taiwan as a nation that caused China to stop climate negotiations, which, you know, is an interesting part of this climate buzz, is, you know, how countries relate to each other also has an impact on, you know, how we're going to work together on climate deals. So if one country gets pissed off at another, says, we're not going to work with you on this anymore, you know, and of course, with China, that's a big deal. And one of the things I said in the article that I thought was interesting, where we're trying to get to half our carbon emissions by 2030, China actually plans to ramp up by 2030 to the highest production ever. So they are going in an opposite direction right now. They're the largest producer of coal in the world, and they're building more coal plants at this time. And it's not until 2060 that China says we are going to kind of cut it all out at 2060.
They've got extra 10 years under that. That plan.
So I just was recognizing just what a difference, you know, between the two, you know.
But on the other hand, China is absolutely dominating the electric vehicle business, and they're building more solar and wind than anybody in the world. So, you know, you got two different things going on. Plus, on a per capita basis, we are just so far ahead of China in terms of our emissions that it's not even comparable. I mean, you got to remember they have close to 1.5 billion people. So there are much, much, many, many, many more people.
What are we at? About
360 million or something like that. So we're about a quarter.
Okay.
The size of China in terms of population. Yeah. And India is actually, China is also, of course, making a contribution, if you call it that, of dramatically reducing their birth rate to where it's a problem now in China to them that their births are so low. I think they're down below our birth rate now, and they're... to where India, of course, has not cut its birth rate. So now India is the most populous country in the world as of this year.
Wow. Breaking news.
Right. Well, I have one more good news story. Or do we have time for that?
Well, I want to give Michelle a story first, and then maybe we'll finish with yours, Brad.
Well, do mine next week. I've saved this one for a couple of weeks.
We'll see what Michelle's got.
I'm glad you brought up the Biden administration. So the Biden-Harris administration has been rolling out the implementation of the Inflation Reduction Act, right?
Yeah.
So there's all these wonderful incentive programs that are being crafted, and they're tricky. Not all of them are perfect. One that was released at the end of June is called Solar for All. And I'm really excited about it because for me, part of what motivates me to do climate work is this intersection of climate justice and fixing this huge, you know, once in a generation problem. But this program is $7 billion directed to low-income households specifically and how they're going to put solar on rooftops. And it's really exciting. They're running a competition of how they're going to distribute that money. And, you know, they're looking at things like workforce development, being able to impact communities that have been burdened by the fossil fuel industry for a long time, and being able to lift those people out of poverty and also make them less reliant on the fossil fuel industry. So I'm super excited. These are huge contracts that are getting rolled out for people that can actually do this kind of reparative work through the clean energy transition. And there's a webinar on Wednesday, I think, that I'm going to be sitting in on just to see how we might even be able to utilize some of this in Western North Carolina. We had a great program through Energy Saver, through the
Neighbor to Neighbor's Hall, still going on with and Sugar
Blue
Hollow.
Horizons Project.
And Clary Franco was on the show.
The Neighbor to Neighbor program, where we actually put free solar on low income folks' roofs right here. So yeah. I like to think that we may have been a little bit of a model. You know, that was part of a Rocky Mountain Institute project. They were monitoring that when it rolled out here. And now the Biden administration is, you know, taking the best ideas. And they've really brought a lot of people into the administration who have been working on climate justice and stuff alongside some of our friends for a long time. So I like to think that those ideas are percolating up from here.
Is it that the low-income neighborhoods benefit, one, by having solar, so in one way they're going to have more affordable, be able to pay less for their power bills and all that?
Yeah.
But is it also kind of trying to help people in that kind of bracket, you know, kind of have their own businesses within this field, and that,
sure,
you know, they're the ones kind of being trained and hired to do this kind of work?
Yeah, that's part of the workforce development component. So, okay, you know, it's a competition because people get to design these programs, and it could be a state, it could be a municipality, or it could be a nonprofit or a tribe. Those are the categories that they've really highlighted. And so they could craft this program anyway. But the you know, Grid Alternatives has a great workforce development program that they've been rolling out in D.C. where they've been doing community installed solar.
Yeah.
So there's some really wonderful models for how to do this kind of what do they call it? Middle out and bottom up economic structures roll. Yeah, that's you know.
Instead of trickle down.
No trickle down. We got to do bottom up and middle out. Mm-hmm. So really just trying to share the wealth in as many ways possible as these huge grants get rolled out. And then also at least a 20% savings on your power bill is what they want. They don't want any model that is not giving people at least a 20% overall annual reduction.
Wonderful. Wonderful.
That's cool.
Well, Brad, why don't you take us out with your last story?
Check it out. This is really an interesting story to me. Penn State University, this is a lab result, but they came across my desk that they have developed something called lion glass. Remember, Penn State's the Nittany Lions, so that's where they came up with the name of lion glass. But it's glass that is 10 times stronger than regular glass for the same thickness. 10 times stronger, which also means that you could build a glass sheet that is double the strength and one-fifth the weight. So, you know, your solar panels would weigh less using this glass. Your windows would weigh less. Your triple pane windows would weigh less. And glass, believe it or not, is responsible for 86 million tons. Glass manufacturing requires a lot of heat, and it's responsible for 86 million tons of carbon dioxide every year with the energy required to make glass. So stronger, lighter, and then in the end, cheaper glass because you just don't need as much of it is a major breakthrough in one industry. And so hats off to those guys. People around the world in all kinds of different industries in energy and material science, and chemistry are working on solving this problem and with improving the technology. So it's, you know, if we can just deploy the technologies, we will solve the problem.
Yeah. Who knows where that in 20 years, right? Where the technology is going to be to be able to do this, you know, and, you know, just we can't imagine it, right? In some sense, like where we are now and where we were 25 years ago.
Of course, you know, somebody just filed to with the FAA to have a flying car. I think we're getting close to the days
of
actually
going to
see the flying car at some point.
It was approved for demonstration purposes. So it is not just applied, it is out there.
Right.
Yeah.
So, and these battery technology breakthroughs that are coming along are going to allow the the flying car. You know, it's just flying car is just a big drone with a person in it.
I want something about the technologies that are yet to be, but we have the technology now. I just really want to harp on that, is that we absolutely have the technology we need to do 100% clean energy and the electrification that we need to curb this. So anyone who says, oh, we're waiting for a breakthrough, it's not ready yet. Oh, no, it's ready and it's available. The problem's political, and we really need to think about that.
All right. Well, we're going to take a short break right here on the Climate Buzz. Brad Rouse, and I'm Bob Hanna, along with Michelle Meyer in the studio today, and we'll be right back. You're listening to The Climate Buzz. I'm Bob Hanna, along with Brad Rouse, and we come to you every Monday, 9 a.m., sharing with you the stories, the people, the science, the challenges, and the solutions of a warming planet. Joining us today in the studio is Michelle Myers, who is the chair of the Blue Horizons Committee, Project Committee, and we're so happy to have you on the air, Michelle, and I thought we'd start with maybe introducing you to our listeners a little bit. What was kind of your journey into to kind of caring about climate and wanting to kind of be part of the solution?
Yeah, wow. I think for me and for many people, when I realized climate change was going to be the thing that defined probably my lifetime, if you think about the arc here, was when I graduated college. I was working for a social justice organization called Citizen Action of New York, and it was 2005. So summer 2005, what happened? Katrina.
Oh, Katrina.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
And I all of a sudden realized, I think as many people did, that this was not some distant future problem. This was a now problem. And this wasn't just something that was going to, you know, have some ambiguous effect on, you know, crop yields. This was actually going to kill people and kill people quickly, you know? And so that's really when I was like, damn, climate change. It took a little while to get into the field. I was doing social justice work, but you know, again, I'm kind of called to climate action because of social justice.
Right.
So Katrina was a big focusing event for me.
It was huge, right? When it comes to social justice. I mean, that was
catastrophe. Yeah. Right? It's just been so many failings of people down in the Gulf Coast for so long, just built up, including the continued extraction of fossil fuels that is literally shrinking the land. Yeah, like the land is submerging while sea levels are rising, more carbon in the atmosphere. Like
what could go wrong?
You know, and then, frankly, gross neglect of infrastructure. So that is, you know, because it was, you know, poor Black communities that just didn't see the investments that they needed to stay safe. So that's why when I say I really get excited about these projects like Solar for All, that we're really looking to repair some of those long-term harms. And I haven't looked yet. There's these things called energy communities in part of the IRA funding that they have highlighted communities that are priority investment areas. And I haven't looked to see what the Gulf Coast looks like, but it should be
full of them.
Heavily invested in, because those people are under the impact of all of the fossil fuel industry. So anyway, that's when I realized it was a problem. It took me a little while. I got out to California, where I lived for about a decade, and I was doing political work, and I ended up working for the Sierra Club, and I was a chapter director out there. And what was really exciting about being in the Bay Area through, you know, 2007 to 2000, right until Trump got elected, was that I was exposed to a lot of really wonderful ideas. They were writing a climate action initiative for Oakland. I got to help facilitate that. And that was really looking, you know, really was part of how are we going to grow food locally? How are we going to transform our transportation system? How are we going to get renewable energy? All of the things that we need to do in an urban environment and in a historically Black environment, you know, in these places that have seen underinvestment for a long time. And oh, by the way, it's a coastal city, right? So also vulnerable to sea level rise.
Yeah.
So that I was, you know, on stage once with Bill McKibben. I've always been really scrappy, right? I'm a community organizer by design. And I was on the state. We were hosting this big, huge protest, and you know, we were doing all these climate protests. They still happen, but they were, you know, I feel like in the 2010 era, 2012 era, there were these huge climate protests,
yes.
Right? So one of the first ones was called Bay Area Moving Planet, and Bill McKibben came to town, and we were all 350.org and Sierra Club. We were all organizing for this thing that was going to pave the way for transit-oriented development, which is so nerdy, but we're just talking about people driving less is really what we're talking about, and car less car infrastructure. And Bill had an iPad, and I needed a way to get people to fill out petitions on the street. And I was like, Bill, can I use your iPad so I can have people, you know, we need their information. We need to figure out a way to get these people to sign up so we can utilize their political capital in order to make the long-term change that mm-hmm. we need, right? And so he said no. He said I could not have iPad to collect petitions on the street. But that was, uh-huh. you know, that was just kind of the type of ideas and people that I was getting introduced to out there. So it was really wonderful. We worked to get a program called Community Choice Aggregation, and now there's oh, yeah. about 26 of them all over the state. The first ones were in the Bay Area. So they were in Marin. Was actually Marin Clean Energy was the first community choice aggregation program, I think, in the country. And that happened, you know, through work that we got to do with Good Minds up in Marin.
That's a really cool program.
So what is it?
Yeah. Community choice aggregation is basically any service provider. So Asheville, you know, Asheville Water Department is a utility. They're a service provider. They could have a power enterprise. So they could just sell electricity right to the people of Asheville if state legislation would allow. So that's a key thing. But you have to pass, you know, break the monopoly a little bit and allow for other entities, municipal entities mostly, to be able to aggregate power. So, you know, largely purchasing power, but they could also build projects and then sell it to customers within their territory. So it's kind of a light breaking of the utility monopoly where we are all reliant on, you know, one utility provider. In that case, it was PG&E. So PG&E is still an essential player in that construct. It's just literally brokering electrons. So we're buying renewable power, we're selling renewable power to customers, but PG&E was still delivering the power, billing for the power, and by the way, shoring up the grid so that there was always a constant supply of power. So just adding renewable electrons to the grid that PG&E controls. But these kind of models are important because we need to think, as I was saying earlier, we need to think about what role our utilities will play in the clean energy future. And making them a partner in that was really important. Now, I'm not saying that they were super excited to just automatically have a competitor.
Right, right. Yeah.
Now, 26 competitors in North Carolina. California.
I'm guessing they fought it, right, all along.
Oh, They fought it. They paid people to fight it.
Figure out how to make it work.
Yeah, well, what they're doing, honestly, is they're charging, not unlike the service charge that you get if you're a solar customer here in Duke service territory, but you're getting paid, you have to pay a surcharge.
Okay.
So they get made whole, but it's more renewable electrons on the grid, and it's a way for people to control where their power comes from because it is something like a government entity, a local government entity that becomes your electricity service provider. So it's really, you get a lot more control, almost like the Blue Horizons Project Community Council that I serve on. There's like a local steering committee. It's not completely unlike some of the municipal utilities that exist in North Carolina, but it was a huge breakthrough at that time in that place where it was all just monopoly controlled.
A lot of ways, though, haven't things moved on from because now we're in a situation where the utilities themselves have to clean up their act. I mean, it's not just a matter of, well, we don't want to be complicit in your being dirty, so I'm going to be a community choice aggregator. I'm going to make sure at least I'm clean by the power that I buy.
Yeah.
I mean, which is a way to push the utility along, but now the utilities are like, have to be fully engaged in this massive decarbonization effort.
Yeah.
And to me, the advantage to the utility, well, you get a problem with a utility like Pacific Gas and Electric, they have a gas company.
Yeah.
I mean, that becomes a conflict of interest in the energy transition because the gas company is just, we can't use gas, can't use fossil gas anyway. There might be some gas that's not fossil, somehow, you know, non-fossil gas, but it's going to be a much larger, smaller role because it's just not going to be in the same supply level. So anyway, it's kind of changed,
they're,
right?
They're phasing out, I'll say methane infrastructure, because I don't call it natural gas, it's methane, right?
Yeah, sure.
So, so they're phasing out, you know, installations of all natural gas, methane utility, or methane appliances. Like, you can't get a
in California
methane hot water heater in California.
Right. Okay.
You know, so they're phasing that out, which means the demand for PG&E's gas infrastructure will go down. So there's ways to push on it if we're smart about policy. And here, and I'm glad you said, you know, we've kind of moved on from there, because Roy Cooper has really been instrumental in helping to push on Duke to get a carbon plan in place, right? So now, we're to the place where maybe CCAs don't make sense. It would be take a lot of political will to do that in North Carolina, because it is state enabling legislation that we would need. And Julie Mayfield's wonderful. She can't do it on her own.
She can't do that.
You know, so I don't see it moving that way here.
She was just here a few weeks ago.
I know, that's,
yeah,
I know.
Telling us what it is right now in Raleigh, right?
Yeah.
Trying to get things done.
Yeah.
So how'd you get to Asheville?
Tell us
that part of the story. Yeah.
Oh, you know how everybody does. We come here, we fall in love. Mm-hmm. Cool nights and beautiful views. Now, I'm from Northern Appalachia, actually, New York State, but it is Northern Appalachia. So I'm a mountain girl.
Fair enough.
I'm an East Coaster for a long time.
Okay.
Was raised up there. And my husband's family was in Florida. So, and they were coming here a lot. And I actually, the first time I met my husband's parents was here. It was about a decade ago. It's over a decade ago. And I think it was just a slow kind of effort for him to get me to transition here. But I came willfully. I actually ended up going to grad school in North Carolina, so I would be credentialed and be able to do this work efficiently here. I went to Duke.
Okay. Into Nicholas School?
I went to the Nick School, yeah.
Okay. Oh, all right.
Yeah, and I got to meet some folks that even work for PG&E and work in these utilities that are working for climate solutions. So I'm hopeful that there are good minds in these big fossil fuel behemoths that are aware of the change that needs to happen, and there will be some shifting, but largely because of political push that we need to force them and force their hand a bit. But yeah, so I moved to Asheville.
When'd you get here?
5 years ago.
Years ago. Okay.
Yep. And I was working for a different nonprofit, the Center for Biological Diversity, and I met Brad at this meeting called the WNC Renewables Coalition.
We were on that group together. You were chair of that group for a while.
For just a bit, yeah, sadly we lost our leader, Carolyn. She was amazing. We were pushing the city and the county to do 100% renewable energy pledges, right? So the county had already done it, actually, and then the city needed to commit. And that was really what we were working on, was trying to get them to commit to this 100% pledge, and they did it. That was another fun thing. In California, we were one of the pilot programs for the Sierra Club's 100% campaign, which is to get 100% renewable energy. So when I got here and you were working on it, I was like, oh, I know this campaign. I ran it in the Bay Area. Let's do it here. We can do this. So eventually they did.
Which is remarkable in itself, right? That we achieved it here.
We did. Well, we achieved a resolution.
A resolution.
And now.
A resolve.
And that's where what you're doing now. That's the work you're doing now.
So the Blue Horizons Project is the kind of the task force that is gets to think about how we're going to transition everything in Buncombe County, every hot water heater, every oil tank, every car, everything that runs on fossil fuels to we're going to electrify everything.
Yeah.
And that's what we have to do here. And we have to do it everywhere. But we're working locally to figure it out. And that's where we're writing a strategic plan, which Brad is also really involved in, on how we're actually going to take that path, how we're going to do it equitably. So we're looking at like the neighbor to neighbor program that was here, is still here. And, you know, other ways that we can invest in underserved communities. But also we really need to get our business partners on board. We need to look at how we're greening the tourism industry, how we're greening large infrastructure, how we're greening industries. You know, the industries that are located here need to be our partners in this transition, because those are, you know, 39% all fossil fuel.
I think
it's
39% is commercial and industrial sectors.
So we need to reach everybody. So everybody needs to be part of the solution.
How is that going, reaching businesses? And you know, is that kind of something that's kind of an ongoing process, and how do they get involved in this?
We've done a few. There's been a few things, right? I mean, but it's not
it's slow.
It's slow.
I would really I would say, you know, okay. So they passed the resolution in 2018.
And what's the timeline for it, too? Just so our listeners.
2042.
Okay.
Is 100% everything renewable by 2042?
Okay.
And then the city and county government have an earlier benchmark, and they are going gangbusters. They're putting solar on schools. They're really investing in renewable energy technologies locally. So they're doing a good job. And then the community partnerships are really, I will say, fledgling. We've done a good job of doing work for solar. We ran this campaign called Solarize Asheville Buncombe, and we got like 175 households to sign up. It was one of the largest programs that Solarize has ever run. And they have run programs all throughout the Southeast and in other areas. So we know residents are on board. We know that you know, they passed this resolution, so we have the political will locally. And now we're really just trying to look at what policy angles we can implement to make it make economic sense for businesses to want to invest in renewable energy infrastructure. So if we're going to find voluntary early adopters, right? Because the state isn't mandating that these people go green, right? So how do we get our local industries to want to do this? And I think the way we have to do is to look at, you know, what kind of land use grants might be available for developers who want to build all, you know, high efficient solar installed, you know, all electric houses. You know, so there has to be an incentive for developers to want to do that and invest in that technology. And I think once they build it, people here are ready and willing to buy it. So we have the market. We just have to invest time and kind of do a lot of relationship development in our industrial and commercial sector. And that's where, you know, I think the volunteers, so the Blue Horizons Project has staff, but the Blue Horizons Community Council has 11 volunteers from different sectors.
Yeah.
We have some local elected officials that serve on it. You know, I serve on it.
Who's our local elected officials on it?
Maggie Allman and Brownie Newman both serve on.
Okay.
And so, you know, head of the county commission and a city council member. And so both are really great allies to have in that space. And, you know, we have some ideas of some policy initiatives that we should move forward. And I think that'll kind of create the culture and create these economic incentives that we're talking about. Mm-hmm. And we need continued movement at the state and federal level as well. So we're not going to figure this out in a vacuum. But I think having people on the ground, again, to build those relationships with our partners is really important. And to do other types of community outreach. You know, we usually have a booth at most local festivals. You can find them. They do something called home energy chats, which you can call them up. Someone will say, oh, great. You've done, maybe you've done some electrifying already. You've replaced your dryer. You know, I had a natural gas, I had a methane dryer when I moved to Asheville. It kept breaking. Oh my God, we had that thing fixed so many times. And I was like, why am I doing this? And we replaced it with electric, and it's been great. You know, so like someone will come to your house and they'll say, okay, you know, you've got good insulation. You've replaced a couple things. These are the next things you need to do in order to make your home more efficient and more electrified, you know? So it might mean switching out your gas stove. I know people don't like that, but really, it improves your air quality in your home when you do this, too. Anytime you have combustion in your home, anytime you're burning methane in your house, you're breathing that in. You and your kids are getting exposed to it. So it's really, there's a lot of benefit. I know, for example, I went solar through the Solarize program. My power bill, with a $12 surcharge from Duke, just for the pleasure of doing business with them, is $26. So you imagine my actual energy use is about $14 a month because of my solar production, which is a huge job.
Right. It makes a big
difference. So you get cleaner air, you save money, and you get to be part of the solution. Why not? Why not electrify everything?
Yeah, or put up a clothesline, right? Put up a clothesline. Hang your clothes. Let the good old sun dry them out.
Yeah, that is a really good
kills bacteria, too. Bonus.
And these clothes last longer.
Yeah. We get a lot of rain here, but, you know.
Well, you got to be sensitive to the weather when you're doing that.
Absolutely. So,
well, no doubt.
We're talking with Michelle Meyer, who's the chair of the Blue Horizons Community Council. And I wanted to give you a chance to talk a little more about social justice, the intersection of climate change and social justice as it relates to the Asheville area, you know, and as kind of what has kind of jumped out at you, you know, you've kind of settled into this town and, you know, things that seem, you know, kind of important to you in that area.
Yeah. So I served on the steering committee that helped create the neighbor to neighbor program. Actually, it's called neighbor to neighbor because I was getting solar on my roof and I looked over my neighbor's roof and I was like, that roof is just as good for solar as my roof. And that person's not going to do this unless it saves them money. And that's how we designed the program. That's why it's called neighbor to neighbor, because I was looking at how the people, the community around me can also be part of the solution. So in terms of, you know, how it really environmental justice comes down, I mean, I think environmental justice can be pretty broadly defined. And to me, It's any time there's been, we can do reparative work where there's been a previous wrong for people who haven't had access to, certainly they don't have an oil well in their backyard. Certainly they're not getting dividends, you know, from some big stock holdings for the fossil fuel industry. Right. How can they see the benefits of the renewable energy industry? And how can they be part of the solution? So, you know, a lot of times we're looking at things like renters or folks who maybe have homes that are, you know, not very efficient, but, you know, in terms of holding in heat and cooling,
right,
because they've just never been updated, right? Their roof hasn't been updated. They don't have insulation worth a damn in their walls because maybe it was installed in 1960, you know, and it's disintegrated. And yeah, and those people...
So, there's so many places in town that don't even have insulation in their attics.
Yeah.
Like, they're, you know, renters move in and there's no... I mean, I've heard that come up number of times.
The whole renter situation is a big problem.
Yeah, the renter situation is a huge problem, and it's a tough nut to crack because
landlords are
The people who are paying the power bill aren't necessarily the people who are have the ability to install solar. So, you know, I think I'm not saying we fix that problem, but you know, it is on our radar, and I think we're looking for creative solutions of how to do. You know, there is maybe a potential for aggregating some power if we could find the right thing that works with our kind of our legislative political confines. But really, neighbor to neighbor solar in particular was an opportunity to give historically marginalized communities, so focusing on the BIPOC community, give people solar. And what that does is it shaves off their monthly bill. You give people free solar, all of a sudden they're spending less money on electricity and they're spending more money on whatever they need, food, you know, getting to work, you know, whatever. Hopefully it just eases the burden, what they call energy burden, a little bit. And I also think that through workforce development, we can do, maybe some alternatives to the tourism industry here. We could have some other kinds of industry that maybe are more secure, less seasonal, better paying jobs. So I think that's another way we can utilize.
Well, you got to mention, you know, Energy Savers Network as part of that whole effort. And we've had several of the people on the show, Jamie and Summer and Kelvin, I think. Was Kelvin on the show?
Yes.
Kelvin and Steffi have all been guests on the show at one time or another.
I wonder why, Brad.
What's that? I have to remember, well, who was on and who wasn't on. Yeah. My memory's getting a little soft. But, you know, just the basic, and people who, I mean, Energy Savers Network is a program of Blue Horizons Project now.
Yeah.
So just people can call them.
So this specifically is a program to weatherize homes that are for low-income folks, right? People who probably might get heating assistance. Like, well, how do you qualify for Energy Savers Network?
200% of the federal poverty level. So we estimate, I was just running the numbers on this for part of the strategic plan, that about 30% of the population of Buncombe County would qualify in terms of the income. So if you're at about 30% of the the bottom 30% of the incomes.
Yeah. And so that's like the first thing you can do to get your home more efficient, to keep the heat
and
cool
it works for renters as well. Yeah. It does work for renters as well as homeowners.
And then that's like tier one of weatherization. And there's tier two. Who's doing the tier two in town? There's another program.
Well, the Community Action Opportunities.
Right.
And Energy Savers is starting to do a little bit of tier two. Tier two would be like replacing your heating system with a more efficient heat pump or really completely insulating your home, which Energy Savers now has the ability to do some of that, but a lot of times they achieve that by referring people to Community Action Opportunities, which is a federal, gets the federal money.
But I think it's a nice partnership when we are able to work together. And then those people also, a lot of them were already income qualified for neighbor-to-neighbor solar. So all these people are homeowners. Some of them aren't eligible because if you're in a mobile home or something like that, it's not really solar ready. But then that rolled into solar. So you get these people that have completely become what we need every home to be is like a high efficiency, solar powered, electrified heating and hot water. And we're starting, you know, starting from the bottom up. Like I said, that's where we have to go because those are the people that have been impacted the worst. I also just want to mention that makes these homes extremely more resilient to high heat days like we were talking about.
Right.
And you know how expensive it is to heat even a trailer with a window unit air conditioner?
No.
So expensive.
Yeah.
So expensive. So, you know, by making these homes more efficient, you're making them more comfortable, but you're also just lowering. People are just literally throwing money out the window, heating and cooling these homes that are not at all insulated.
And it's all about, keeping the carbon dioxide emissions down, right?
Right, and doing it in a, just a way that, that improves the, some of the underlying
quality of lives, too, at the same time. Yeah. All right, we got a short break right here on the Climate Buzz. We'll be right back. This is the Climate Buzz. I'm Bob Hann, along with Brad Rouse and Kelly Sheehan. Will be back in the studio next week, so it'll be good to have her back. And joining us today in the studio has been Michelle Myers, who serves as the chair of the Blue Horizons Project Community Council that advises the work of the Blue Horizons Project. And Michelle, it's been really great to have you on the show today.
Yeah.
So it sounds like... you've got your plate full here and getting us transitioned to a clean energy future. So
yeah, it's a community. It really will take a community-wide effort. So it keeps a lot of people's plates full, and hopefully
and there's
everybody has
for
a little piece of it. Yeah,
something for everybody to do.
Yeah. Well, you Michelle, you have a green tip of the day for our listeners. So
I think I'm going to say go to BlueHorizonsProject.com and sign up for a clean energy home audit. I mean, it's free. Someone will talk to you. They'll tell you what you've done. They'll see if you're income qualified, you might end up, you know, with Energy Savers Network or even solar on your roof. Or if you can afford it, they might tell you how to take advantage of some of these tax rebates that are available through the Inflation Reduction Act that I was talking about earlier. So there are more incentives on the table right now than there ever have been to get an electric vehicle, to get a high efficiency heat pump, to change out your hot water heater for something that isn't powered on methane.
Yeah.
Electric, so do it.
Electric vehicle. That sounds like
well, there's
idea.
A lot of incentives for that.
Or electric bike.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, those are going hot for sure.
Electric bikes are the number one electric mode of transportation in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Or electric scooters anyway.
Yeah.
So I have one.
Yeah. I have one.
Pretty cool. Pretty cool. A lot of fun.
Well, speaking of the Center for Biological Diversity, we had Will Harlan on the show not too long ago, and I saw that this Thursday, he's inviting people to speak for the trees, that there is going to be the U.S. Forest Service is considering a rule to protect old-growth forest on federal lands, which, you know, is the area he's working on up by Burnsville area, right?
Okay.
That's what he's trying. And they need to hear from us. A virtual public hearing is scheduled for Thursday, July 13th at 7 p.m. And this will be a chance for people to tell the Forest Service why it's important to protect old growth forests in your backyard and across the country. And there is a place you can go to register so you can be part of that virtual hearing. And I put it up on the Climate Buzz Facebook and Instagram page. So you can find that information there and feel free to like or follow us there. And
cool.
Yeah. So I thought that was a great opportunity for people to get involved. So also, what was I going to say there? We've got the podcast up and running. We are on Spotify now. So if you go to Spotify and put in the Climate Buzz, I think all of May's episodes are up and soon to be June's too. So with the help of Mike Engel, who has kind of taken these shows for us and turning them into podcast form. So that's exciting too.
So you can go out. If you missed all of today's show, you'll be able. Well, if you missed today's show, it's going to be the last 2 weeks are on the website, the full episode. The Spotify podcasts are a little shorter because we leave some of the
underwriting music out.
Underlying music out and that sort of thing. So they're a little shorter, but I'm looking forward to seeing all of that.
Yeah. Well, again, Michelle, thanks so much for coming out today. I hope you come back and kind of keep us abreast of kind of what's going on in your kind of your corner of the climate world. So
absolutely.
Always good to know. Yeah.
Thanks for the invitation to be here.
Thanks for listening to the Climate Buzz podcast. If you enjoyed the show, please share with your friends and find us on Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube, where we promise to keep you up to date with all the Climate Buzz.
We want to acknowledge and thank Asheville FM volunteer Mike Engel for his time and effort in producing and uploading the Climate Buzz podcast every week that allows us to reach more people who are concerned about the unfolding climate crisis. We invite you to check out Asheville FM's website, www.ashevillefm.org, where you can listen live, check out the Climate Buzz page with archives of our latest show, as well as have access to all the Asheville FM radio programs that inspire our listeners to build connections across communities and to discover new music and ideas.